Hey everyone, I'm Sam. I'm here today with Annie Liew. Annie is an awesome designer and web developer. Annie, thanks so much for joining us. And today I was hoping we could talk a little bit about learning web development and the process of learning and how you kind of grow as a web developer. And your journey has been really interesting because you have kind of introduced yourself as a beginner web developer, as a blogger and on social media a while ago. And I feel like we've watched you kind of grow into like a rather advanced developer. So can you tell us a little bit about what has it been like to go through that process of learning web development, but actually parlaying that into teaching others and sharing that experience with others?
Yeah, for sure. I'm really happy to be here. I just want to say that I'm definitely not a advanced web developer by any means, first of all. So yeah, I just wanted to get that out there. But so the idea of sharing online, one of the things that I personally kind of struggle with is keeping myself accountable to, you know, to get the work done, because I actually find web development like quite, it's really interesting, but at the very beginning, it wasn't something that I was interested in at all. So teaching in public, I guess, or sharing my learnings, I kind of think of it more sharing my learnings, is a way to keep me accountable to actually doing the work, because I feel like, oh, other people are kind of relying on me or I'm doing something. So that helps in actually like doing that. And the reason I started 100 Days of Code was because at my previous job at an agency, I wasn't really growing as much anymore. So I wanted to actually learn some new skills. And that was the whole reason behind doing 100 Days of Code and learning.
And can you tell us what is 100 Days of Code and what's that experience been like for you?
Yeah, definitely. So 100 Days of Code is, I guess it's like a concept really, where you actually commit to doing 100 days of code. It's supposed to be consecutive, where you actually do 100 days of 1 hour a 1 hour a day every day on something that you're learning related to programming. At the time, I was working full time and I was also freelancing in design, so I wasn't able to do it consecutively all the time. And I think for myself as well, I'm a big advocate of like resting when you need to. I feel like there's a big thing about, you know, hustling all the time, but it's you know, we're in the middle of a pandemic as well right now, and it can be really difficult to consistently keep going, and especially when I was working full-time and also freelancing at the same time. So I had to kind of give myself permission to rest when I needed to. But yeah, it's basically you do 100 days of code consistently and you share your progress on Twitter and connect with other developers who are going through the same journey, and you know, like encourage them and while you share your work as well. And it's a really good idea as a way to keep yourself accountable. And for me myself, I think before doing 100 days of code, like I really didn't know how to use Twitter at all. It was like, what do I write? So that was a really big introduction for me to the Twitter developer community.
And so is it through 100 days of code that you kind of grew this community and connected and actually garnered a substantial Twitter following in the Twitter developer world?
Absolutely. I think I started 100 days of code at the end of March 2020 and or like beginning of April. And before that, I maybe had about 300 followers. So it hasn't even been a year right now that I've really been using Twitter consistently.
Okay. Wow, cool. And you mentioned sharing your learnings. So like practically speaking, what does that look like?
One of the things that I try to do when I'm sharing my progress on like Twitter specifically is I think about the idea of like when I'm sharing, I'm not just saying I did this A, B, and C. I try to think about, okay, if someone is reading this, is there something that they can take away from it? I know it's hard with Twitter because you're not really, you don't have a lot of words to play with. And but I try to think about, okay, if someone can take away something small, whether they can be inspired by it, because people want to be entertained. So part of the things I think about is, can they actually have something practical that they can apply by looking at this, you know, piece of tweet that I've done, or will they be inspired by something that I'm sharing? So I guess like through that process of thinking about how can I kind of structure my tweets in a way, and it kind of grew. Like at the beginning, it wasn't so much like that, but as I went through that journey, like it very much quickly became like, how can I teach other people? Because the best way to actually learn yourself is by teaching. And so that was, those were the kind of thoughts that went through my mind as I was tweeting. Like, what am I learning, and how can I convey an idea, or how can I entertain, or how can I actually, you know, teach a small thing to the audience, I suppose.
Do you have
so
advice?
They're just really like bite chunks.
That's so cool. Do you have advice for other developers who are getting started learning and might want to share their progress and share their learnings on Twitter?
Yeah, I think one of the things that is important is just to have your own voice and to be authentic. I think it's really easy to get caught up with what everyone else is doing and feel like, oh, I have to, you know, tweet a particular way or talk about something. But people, you know, you always have your own kind of weird, and people will resonate with that. So like, basically, like, definitely, you know, do the things that you want to do, share it, and also interact with other people. And in terms of, you know, thinking about the kind of work that you want to share, think about what can someone take away from it. So it's not just kind of, you know, you pushing everything out, but it's like kind of what value can this tweet provide for someone who is reading it, I suppose, or watching it these days. And that would be kind of my advice.
How do you think, so continuing this thread about learning web development, how do you think learning actually fits into your job as a web developer?
Yeah, that's really, really huge, actually. There is an idea in, I guess, web development specifically as a career, is that the learning never ends. And when I first actually started my current job, I work at a startup right now. There's only four of us at this particular moment. But when I was working at previous jobs, I had this mentality that, okay, I've learned what I needed to learn at uni or whatever courses that I'm doing, and then I'm bringing those skills to this particular job. But at this job right now, I got hired, you know, based on like skills that I actually didn't have at the moment. I was doing a lot of HTML and CSS in a WordPress environment in my previous job. And this job is like React, Redux, TypeScript. And it was extremely, and it has been very, very intensive and intimidating. One of the things that my CTO has really said to me, he said, because I had this idea that coming to this job, part of, and it is part of the reason that I was supposed to, you know, push features and everything. But he said the number one thing for me to focus on right now is just to improve. Shipping features is secondary to that. So learning right now at this stage of the job is basically the number one thing that I'm doing, and I'm trying to improve really, really fast. I've shipped features and everything, but as a as like where it fits into the place of my job, it's like so important. It's like the number one most important thing that I do right now, just to learn and to get better, and so that I can contribute a lot faster, and, you know, all those good things.
Yeah, it's such an amazing experience. And one thing I didn't realize before I started job hunting is that companies will actually hire young developers to actually learn an entire new language. Like, I got one job offer in Java, and I have a friend who just learned JavaScript and got a job offer in PHP. Like, we can expect to have that level of learning and training in some cases.
Definitely. And that was very unexpected to me. I didn't really think about, or I've never really came across that idea that, you know, a company will hire you with the expectation that you will be able to pick up the skills on the job. So it's, I think it's quite beautiful about, you know, the development community and jobs in a whole.
And so I understand you've been hired as employee number one at your company.
Yes.
What has that experience been like?
It's been really, really interesting. At this job, it's quite flat. We don't really have, you know, like a very big, like, hierarchical management, I guess. So I have a ton of autonomy about how I handle my days and a lot of say in where the app is going, like the actual features and the way it looks and feels. And it's quite incredible. I'm so grateful to have that level of, I guess, like autonomy over my work and being able to impact on a really very, very significant level, like the direction of where the app is going. If I think about some of the previous jobs, like typically you're going to get, tickets and things handed to you from management and you're going to have to work on it. But in this situation, like I'm actually in charge of what I do and like what kind of move forward, like how I plan my week out and what I'm working on. And it's been a very, very interesting and different experience from any other work that I've ever done.
That sounds almost kind of intimidating. And I understand you've been kind of in a mentorship relationship with your CTO. Can you tell us what has that experience been like and what would your tips be for other developers who might be looking to work with a mentor?
Yeah, that's been an amazing experience. He's such a smart person and he's also very, very empathetic and kind. And you just never guess how actually intelligent and smart he is because he's so, down to earth. But my CTO has been coding since he was 8 years old. His mom taught him when he was 8. Yeah, so I think a lot of like me coming into this environment and him having such a big difference, like in the gap of like knowledge and just how long that he's done this for, it's been very like the imposter syndrome is very real because like I'll be working on something, I'll be, okay, how long will it take you to do this? And he'll be like, oh, it'll take probably a couple of hours. And it'll literally take me 2 weeks to do the same thing because I'm doing so much learning and trying to understand all the concepts along the way. But he's been a really great mentor in the sense that one of the things that we spoke about very recently, and this was just last week, he said to me, I think you're not asking enough questions. And this is true, like in our one-on-one, I started asking a lot of questions in the beginning, but I think I was starting to feel a bit like, oh, I don't want him to feel like I'm stupid for not knowing this. So I would actually go and ask my friends, hey, like, how do you, like, what does this mean? Like, what's the difference between A and B? And I think he noticed. He was like, I feel like you're not asking me enough questions. So I want to give you permission. So please ask me questions. And we have a very, very open, I guess, relationship. So like we talk about a lot of different things and we talk about things like the importance of vulnerability, for example, and where we want to see the future of the company culture and a lot of really interesting things beyond just actual coding and the technical things about coding. So it's been a really great experience having him as a mentor.
That's awesome.